It has absolutely been a crash course on Zika.
So what's this guy right there?
In October 2015 was the first time I think anybody in this building had heard of Zika virus. But we very quickly realized that we had among us here at UW a unique group of scientists with complementary expertise who could hopefully really contribute to understanding how the virus works and how it causes disease.
So you can see these guys are
almost all fed.
Because we have a medical school, we have a veterinary school, we have an insectary facility to produce mosquitoes, we have a containment insectary facility to infect mosquitoes, we have a national primate center that allows us to do these non-human primate experiments. And if you wanted to expand beyond the basic sciences, I know there's discussions on campus and social sciences, because with Zika virus and these pregnancy issues, there's a whole host of issues associated with women's rights. Some countries have recommended that women put off pregnancy.
We've experimentally infected a series of rhesus monkeys with the virus to understand the immune responses to Zika virus and how maternal infection can impact on fetal well-being and fetal development.
She's determining the fetal heart rate.
We'll be looking at the trajectory of fetal growth as they go through the length of gestation. So with the animal model, we can obtain detailed information throughout the course of pregnancy that really isn't going to be available with clinical human patients.
And so we've been giving a lot of thought to how you can safely work with viruses that you don't know very much about and how you could develop animal models for them. And we've already done some of this work for other viruses that aren't Zika. So we were able to apply many of the same strategies that we had used for other viruses to Zika.
Then we also have some groups studying Zika in Colombia. So we have field collection of mosquitoes. We started creating this network of scientists and group of people discussing ideas together, coming up with new approaches to try to find solutions to the problem. I think it's very important for us to have that contact face-to-face with people and in these countries, in Colombia, in Brazil, because they are the ones that are having the issues, having the problems. And so for us to hear from them, finding joint solutions to the problems is very important for us too.
Mosquitoes liberados.
And what this means is that we're able to advance more quickly than if we were doing it all in our own individual silos. And I think that this is a really important precedent that will hopefully be useful not only against Zika virus, but against other emerging infectious disease outbreaks in the future. The more we work together, the more we'll be able to accomplish quickly.
These are becoming all too common, and it has a lot to do with a number of different factors associated with changing viruses, changing human behavior, changing environments that are all facilitating these large outbreaks of these emerging infectious diseases.
Every time we go through this, we learn a little bit about how to respond to a new outbreak and how to make things happen faster.
We all are really working from a different perspective towards this common goal, and it would be just a fantastic outcome if some of the results that we get with the animal model can both help with disease prevention by, say, giving new insights into insect control, as well as increase the toolbox for preventing adverse outcomes and helping treat pregnant women who have been infected with the Zika virus. And everyone is contributing in a very unselfish way, because we see this as an important goal, and the University of Wisconsin can make unique contributions.